Welcome to the Smarter Tech Podcast. I'm your host, Nick, the EMF Guy Pinot, and I'm here with Professor Olle Johansson, straight from Sweden. Professor Johansson, it's an honor to be able to interview you today.
Well, likewise. Thank you so much for that very kind introduction, you know.
Well, let us know a little bit more about your credentials and your career, but maybe the two-minute version, if possible, so we have more time for the interview, because I know you've been spending most of your life on the topic of electromagnetic fields and their effects on human health, but maybe walk us through your scientific background first.
Yes, I started as a medical student at the Karolinska Institute here in Stockholm, Sweden, and very soon got interested in research and ended up at the group dealing with the central and peripheral nervous system. So I became a neuroscientist, knowing a little bit about the brain, the spinal cord, and the peripheral nerves, and how they help us to move around in the world and sense it and feel it and see it and taste it, and also to make various forms of thoughts and ideas coming through. Mm-hmm. And then one evening, I actually listened to a radio program, which I never actually do. It was a mistake. Someone had left, someone had left the radio on, and I was about to turn it off and leave the laboratory and go home. And then I heard a woman, and her name is Kajsa Vedin. She was talking about people, and this is in the beginning of the 1980s. People that had gone skin irritations and skin rashes, heat sensations, pricking pain in front of the very newly introduced personal computers here in Sweden. And I learned very quickly that Sweden was not at all first. The first cases came from United States and from Norway. And I got very interested, actually, because what she told the radio listeners made sense to me. So I contacted her. And that's really the reason why we talk today. Hadn't I done it, or had I just gone past the radio, we would never have met and talked. It's really very strange to think about, actually.
But it's been a long journey since.
Yeah, that set me out on a very long journey. And it also grew tremendously from the electro hypersensitivity she was talking about to general health and biological effects of all kinds of artificial electromagnetic fields. And of course, today there is a kind of explosion of interest around the newly introduced fifth generation mobile telephony, but also other forms of wireless transmission of information. And since then, I have been retired in 2017, but I'm still too active, I would call it. You know, I work too much. And it's very, very interesting. And from a scientific point of view, I try to continue as much as I can. But of course, not being connected to an academic institution any longer hampers me a little bit. But there are so many very kind people out there that wants to collaborate. They have all the academic resources. So we are doing quite well after all.
This is great to hear. I know since 2017, I saw you at various times ask the community, it's activists, health-conscious individuals, EMF mitigation specialists, the public, to help you continue your research, which is, to me, it sounds crazy, because the entire topic of EMF, studying the effects of EMF radiation, deserves more attention, and to have a scientist of your caliber kind of with funds running dry, it's a shame. But I'm glad that things are continuing for your research and that you're busy as can be, as much as you want to be busy.
But I could honestly say, had we more resources, we could, of course, engage much more. Yeah. So the fundraiser call is still 100% active. And if anyone out there wants to contribute, please do, because even a single American dollar or a Japanese yen or a South African rand will make a difference. And we are trying our hardest 24/7 to get people into the whole area. But, you know, it's like living. You cannot buy milk in the store if you don't have the money. So money is crucial, I'm sorry to say. But nevertheless, we try our hardest.
This is tremendous. And Talking now about the lack of research, we're going to dive straight into 5G this year in 2020. Actually, this is released in 2021, so early 2021. Obviously, if we talk about 2020, to me, as someone who's been in the topic for just around 5 to 6 years as a personal interest and then 4 years full time, 2020 has changed everything in 5G awareness. Not necessarily at all times for the good reasons. There's been a lot of speculations, a lot of links between 5G and the coronavirus crisis that went worldwide, this pandemic, a lot of uncertainty, and then unfortunately, a big pushback against anyone who dares say that 5G is dangerous is even more of a quack than before, because I've been called that, and possibly you have been called that. I mean, even the scientists who are very serious in their fields have been called that in many aspects. So let's dive into what is 5G briefly, and did we really study 5G before rolling out this new generation of cellular networks worldwide?
Well, we definitely did not study 5G as we did not with 4G, 3G, 2G, 1G, and a whole bunch of other forms of electromagnetic fields. They were just given to us, and of course, with the best intentions. And we could, for instance, not do this interview without electricity, no lightning, and nothing like that. And also without the computer power and the digitalization and all of it. So it was, of course, very nice inventions, but at the same time, they do emit colossal levels of electromagnetic fields, both in the extremely low frequency range as well as high frequency signals up in the gigahertz frequency window. And 5G is just yet another version, even more complicated. I talked to a friend I have who is an expert on 1 to 4G, and he said that technically 5G is so much more complicated, so it's even hard for him to know all the details. But the idea is, of course, that we should use wireless systems even more, and this is much more powerful, faster in all aspects, and hopefully will generate a lot of more services to the general public. It has focused beams that is creating a lot of question marks. It's pulsed and modulated in another different way, so there are question marks about it. But I would still say it boils down to the same questions that we have learned from 1 to 4G and wireless internet and power lines and whatnot. And for me, it's of course strange to see that you roll out such a very new high-tech system without having cleared all the question marks of the earlier versions. And they are still on the table. And some of the question marks are quite scary, I would say. Impacts on bacteria, impacts on plants, impacts on pollinators, including honeybees. Questions about very, very severe questions about impacts on male sperm cells and the immune system, leakage of the blood-brain barrier, damage to the DNA, maybe even propelling forward the incidence of various cancer forms, etc. All those questions are still not solved, and they are on the table. And then instead of looking at it, they come forward with a fifth version. At the same time, it should not be forgotten that all the major players, including, of course, the operators, the manufacturers of telecom technique, and above all, the insurance and reinsurance companies, have left ship many years ago. The insurance companies, actually, more than 20 years ago, then they bailed out and said, no. For us, it's not the question whether it's dangerous or not. We know it's dangerous, they said. The question is only who is going to pay for all the economic demands that future, for instance, cancer patients will put forward in courts of law. And we don't want to do that. So therefore, they have in their small print, very clear-cut avoidance behaviors regarding the liability and responsibility. And the same you can actually say about radiation protection authorities. who has on their own websites recommendations to keep these safe gadgets away from your body and to make short calls, etc. You know, it's a little bit like giving a kid a snake and tell them only play with it for a short time. It is safe, we hope, but only play with it for a short time. And so that also can be said about the World Health Organization, who has cancer classified electromagnetic fields, both, again, extremely low frequency fields in association with childhood leukemia, and radio frequent fields, all categories, and their associations with brain tumors. And I recently had quite a fantastic experience. So recently, I shouldn't say, it was somewhere in March, April, I went with a commuter train here in Stockholm. And since no one knows who I am, you know, I always take the chance to put a seed in the mental soil and inform people and educate them a little bit. And there was a very posh lady sitting there with her smartphone. So I leaned forward and said, do you know that the World Health Organization in Geneva in Switzerland has actually cancer classified the radio frequency fields from this smartphone? And she got angry, to say, tell you the least, you know, really, and said that I was stupid, I didn't know anything, I should mind my own business and so on. And I said, well, please, 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 you have a smartphone. Why don't you Google WHO cell phones and brain tumors and look for yourself? And actually she did. And she started to Google and she went silent for 2-3 minutes. And then suddenly she turned to me and said, slowly, you are completely right. I'm sorry I yelled at you, you know. It's all here. But now I get very angry again, but not on you, she said to me, but on our government, parliament, and health authorities. They have not informed me about this. And, you know, she said, I'm not only a mother, I'm a grandmother. And just a week ago, I gave my granddaughter a brand new smartphone, and now I regret it. And by then, I had reached my station. She should continue. So I don't know what happened thereafter, but hopefully she connected with, for instance, the Prime Minister and the Minister for Health, etc., and with authorities, including the Radiation Protection Authority, and started to ask them questions, because at least in Sweden, most people are completely uninformed. Myself and a colleague to me, we actually did write a letter to the Prime Minister, not about the health effects, but more about the economic effects. Would an American lawyer win a case in the United States? That could have a tremendous impact on Swedish economy, being based so much on telecom industry. Our prime minister, his name is Stefan Löfven. He chose not to answer the letter, but instead he gave it to another minister, Isabella Lövin. She didn't answer either, and she gave it to a civil servant. And this poor woman, she didn't know anything. So, of course, her response finally, after a very, very long time, was kind of blah, blah, blah. It didn't give us anything back. And for me, it's a little bit, how should I say, disappointing, because, you know, to be a Swede, that's kind of nice. Apart from that, you have to pay a lot of taxes. Yeah. And then you want to have something back, at least a little bit more informed and intelligent answer to our very short question. But we didn't get it. We wrote an article actually in English and sent it out to all the people on our mailing list, because we felt that we would like to inform people around the world how it's being dealt with here in Sweden. And funny enough, or should we say not so funny, a lot of people who receive this in all corners of the planet started to write emails back saying, oh yeah, it's exactly the same situation here. We get no contact whatsoever with government, parliament, health authorities, radiation protection authorities, and so on. They don't give a toss about it. Or maybe they do, but have then decided not to answer any questions, which is in a sense, a little bit scary, because as a Swede, you want to praise yourself of living in a real democracy. And in a democracy, adults actually do talk with each other.
Yeah, this is, how can I put it? I thought about the term hot potato. You know, everyone is passing around that hot potato of EMFs. No one wants to deal with it, but it's hot, and they have to pass it around to another minister, another agency, and say, no, it's you, no, it's you. So the FDA, at the end of the 90s, mandates the NTP, the National Toxicology Program, to run one of the most important study in history on radio frequency radiation and their effects on rats and mice. What they find in fall of 2018 is clear evidence that it's a carcinogen in for certain tumor types. And the FDA's response, they mandated, they passed the hot potato to NTP. Their response is, well, this doesn't apply to humans. So, I mean, it's incredible. Another example that I want to dive into is a very fascinating thing you said in the presentation about Professor Paolo Vecchia, who presented in 2008 at the Royal Society in London, UK. And he said that he talked about the ICNIRP guidelines. And just for listeners who aren't familiar with ICNIRP, it's the International Commissions for Non-Ionizing Radiation Protection. Could we say one of the most important regulatory bodies in the world when it comes to EMF protection? At least that's what we think they are, but even from their own words, what you said in your presentation, the ICNIRP guidelines, so our, let's say, cell phone radiation limits and other wireless limits, they're not mandatory prescriptions for safety. They're not defensive walls for industry or others. They're not the last word on the issue, which is the health effects or lack thereof. And the guidelines are only technical in nature and were never meant to be used as medical or biological exposure guidelines. How is that for a shocker to me when I heard that from you? Can you address? So ICNIRP says, no, we're not responsible for health effects. And yet other health agencies and regulatory bodies all around the world say, well, no, it's ICNIRP who's responsible for these health effects. So how does that work?
Yeah. Well, again, as you say, they're passing a very hot potato around. And Paolo Vecchia, being at that time in 2008, the head of ICNIRP, he was very good and actually rather angry, because he pointed to that they had never meant that ICNIRP, that this should be used for biology or medicine. And he pointed several times to that you just cannot use these guidelines that are only technical in nature. And then, of course, being technical in nature, they work beautifully well if you want to compare one cell phone with the other, one antenna construction with another, and so on. But if you move them from the technological side to the medical or biological side, you just cannot use them at all. And still, as you say, including the World Health Organization and a lot of other very, very big and important bodies around the world, they do lean on this and refer to ICNIRP. And I'm disappointed, to be honest, to see that ICNIRP should, of course, officially stand up and say, stop, you cannot do this any longer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You have to construct, and that has been asked for many, many years, true biological and medical guidelines that could be used for safety of humans, animals, plants, bacteria, whatever, you know. But they keep silent and continue their work as if nothing had happened.
Yeah, so it's not, they're kind of washing their hands. It's not their responsibility. Everyone else is going to figure it out. In the meantime, you have Health Canada and the FCC would say, well, look at it, ICNIRP. These guys say it's perfectly safe. Then the cancer societies would say, well, look at the FCC and Health Canada. So it's the same information. It's a loop.
Yeah.
And then we're lost. And then this report from Investigate Europe in 2018 calling ICNIRP, how did they put it exactly? They talked about an industry cartel, which is a big deal. They talked about basically Exactly what we're talking about. So all the agencies are referring to each other with the same scientists, the same engineers. And then they talked about, of course, the lack of experts who understand both the engineering and the physics and the biology, so the biophysics of these EMLs. Because in the end, if you're only technical in nature, you can be the best electrical engineer on the planet. And I've had several argue with me over, of course, no, there's no health effects and this and that, but do you really understand what's the voltage gradient of a cell? Or do you understand mitochondrial energy or the work of Paul Heru, for example, who demonstrates that extremely low levels of intensity or many different types of field can affect mitochondria? Do you understand this? And they're silent, of course, because it's not their expertise and it's not mine either. I'm just the journalist asking questions here, but I don't have answers. So what expertise do we need? How do you think we can get out of that ICNIRP conundrum? Is there a group, like I know there's a group in the UK, I cannot recall the name right now, with Dr. Erica Mallory Blythe and others like Alasdair Phillips. They're trying to come up with new standards. Is there a group that you think could potentially, I guess, replace ICNIRP? If ICNIRP wants to take care still of the technical stuff, it would be okay. But we need a group that understands biology that would take over for sake of humanity.
Yeah, I agree to 100% with that, you know. And to go back to the different bodies that communicate with each other, it has been demonstrated several times that it's not only the actual official bodies, but also the members are more or less equally the same. They rotate between the different offices and handing over information actually to themselves. But since like a year back, there are two or maybe even three groups that try to do what you ask for, to construct like a parallel new ICNIRP dealing with the biology and medicine. We haven't seen it officially launched yet, but it could be a possibility. And again, as we started the whole discussion with, what they need is, of course, monetary support, because it is very difficult to run these different bodies without to have a real office and real meeting rooms, etc. So the finances are important. And at the same time, I think it wouldn't take very much time to actually come up with at least some preliminary suggestions regarding biologically based guidelines, because the knowledge among, you mentioned Paul Heru, for instance, there are a lot of other very good scientists and medical doctors who we could get together, like Erica Mallory Blythe and a lot of other people. And I think they could do the job rather quickly and then trim down all the details. And I believe when we talked another time that we touched upon parallel to the evolution of like 4G, 5G, soon even 6 and 7G, there is also an evolution among particularly concerned parents, I would say. They are very, very much onto these questions worldwide, not only in Canada or United States or Sweden. They are everywhere, you know. And they are asking super intelligent and very basic and good questions. And they kind of boil down to, is this really safe for my children and for me and my family, yes or no? And then, as you say, most of these official bodies run out of the room. They don't want to even touch this question.
Yeah.
And if I'm asked it, I would immediately say, no, it's not safe. Definitely not. We need various forms of solutions, either to turn it off or invent new gadgets and new solutions. And that particular word, solutions, have been very prominent the last 5 years when I have been around the world giving lectures and interviews, etc. And many persons actually ask that, what can we do? What kind of technical solutions are there? And also from a behavioral point of view, what can we do? Can we limit the number of cell phone calls or the length of them, or what should we actually do? And I cannot tell you which, but one of the biggest car manufacturers in the world have started to show interest in producing a car in which you would not be subjected to all these microwave and extremely low frequency radiation, because more and more consumers are asking for details. You know, when you buy like a car, traditionally you would look for the brand, the model, the color. But nowadays, as you know, cars look very much the same to each other. It's sometimes even difficult to know, is it a Volvo or is it a Volkswagen? Or what is it actually, you know?
Yeah,
and therefore the car manufacturers, they are looking for other details where health concerned people, animal lovers, for instance, who don't want to subject their pets to this radiation. You can have people that are health conscious in different ways, parents, of course. And there are new ways to maybe produce and sell cars. And it could prove also legally to be a very smart move. And if you make a car like that, why not make a lot of other things in a similar way? Already I could tell you that in Japan, there are car manufacturers that have a switch inside the car. And when you turn it off, you lose the wireless internet inside of the car and all the radiation which goes with it. It's small detail, but again, you know, Japanese people are very health concerned. They are very much prone on talking about safety, personal safety. So, and you know, Japan is not a small market. So here we have considerable possibilities. And soon in Poland, here in Europe, it has been delayed, but soon this low SAR, low specific absorption rate cell phone will be launched. You have other similar gadgets and solutions. The Swedish RP of Sweden, Radiation Protection, RP of Sweden, which is a company which makes cases, you can call it, for cell phones, tablets, baby alarms, Wi-Fi routers that will reduce the radiation quite dramatically. And they have not done the measurements. It has been done independently by a company in Finland called Verkoton. And they have shown that these cases will bring down the radiation somewhere in the order of 70 to 90%. For some models, even as much as 99%. And for single models, 99.9%. So it's really a dramatic reduction without impacting the connectivity or the battery lifetime. So it still functions as it did before, but you have at least cut off quite a lot of the radiation. And I see more and more interest. Before, you know, the most common call I would have would be actually from a concerned parent, followed by a lawyer. And that would be the second most common call. But nowadays, more and more people are looking rather for general solutions. They don't have any real problems. They are just very concerned. And they want to reduce the radiation impact as much as possible. And a few days ago, I was together with a colleague and did measurements here in Stockholm in an area called Östermalm, where the, well, richer people, you can say, live, maybe even rich people. And we were in a flat and we looked on shielding of windows with a new film, plastic film, that technically had been shown to reduce 99.98%, and still with a very clear visibility. You hardly could notice when you put it on the window. So together with other similar shielding tools, you can bring down the indoor radiation quite a lot. And the family here, they were especially concerned about their teenage daughter, which had been heavily exposed to a base station outside of their flat, hanging on the opposite building.
Yeah.
So things like that is happening.
Yeah, I agree that it's been exploding. You mentioned the cell phone company. I don't mind calling them Mudita. is the company, MUDITA. It's going to be in the show notes and underneath the video. But I want to say I purchased a Mudita to do a review, and I can't wait to have mine. But with coronavirus, the manufacturing has been very difficult, obviously. It's good to see that at least there's one company in the world that has a tech startup that is more health oriented. And I was chatting with my colleague Brian Hoyer in a few days ago, and you know, I think it's moving towards this movement. A lot of people realize that their cell phone is addictive, and that we need to disconnect and maybe take these low tech weekends, for example, go camping with the kids, and everyone leaves the cell phones and the tablets and the laptops and the wearables at home. So I think part of this movement, eventually people are going to also think in terms of low EMF. Look, this radiation isn't good for us. Why don't we reduce it this weekend, and we'll all feel better. But I know also I want to put you on the spot a little bit, because I have you on the line here, and some people in the scientific community could say or have called, for example, groups like Bioinitiative or certain of the appeals that have been done, like the EMF scientist appeal or even the 5G from space appeal. They call it fear-mongering. So their assessment of the science, these, let's say, EMF skeptics, is... yes, it's okay that you talk about the precautionary principle, but really it shouldn't be applied because we don't have the indications necessary to apply this principle. So what's the difference between your work and the work of independent scientists that I'm following, Paul Heroux and, I mean, Dr. Mallory Blight, Belpom in France with electrical hypersensitivity? There's dozens and dozens of them that I'm following. What's the difference between this group of scientists who says, we need to take urgent steps to reduce exposure because we already have sufficient evidence of harm or sufficient indications that we could have harm in the long term. And the other group of scientists that says, no, really, there's no indication. And sometimes they even say there's zero indication of harm. So how could they say that?
Well, to begin with, I hope that the other side is right. Because, you know, I'm like a mental fire brigade soldier. And like the ordinary fire brigade, if I arrive at the scene and there is no fire, no danger, nothing, I would, of course, not start crying and be angry. I would be happy. I would be happy for myself, for my colleagues who don't need to risk their lives in a big fire. And also, of course, for people not losing their homes and their workplaces and not getting injured in any way. So I would be extremely happy. But at the same time, even you know, with the toughest regiment, and if you look on science, you just cannot sweep all the papers under the carpet. There are just too many, they're too well done, and they're too many times replicated. So it's really impossible to do it. Then, of course, you mentioned various compilations like the Bioinitiative report and the Benevento resolution and the Venice resolution and the Sellertun statements on. All of them are very good, but they are compromises. Had other people written them, they would have looked maybe kinder to the audience or harsher. Had I written some of these compilations, I would probably have been even tougher, because I have been taught to always be safe rather than sorry. And being an academic scientist in the medical field, I don't need to protect the industry or the finance of a country or a company or the politics or something. Other persons take care of that. I don't need to make your interview coming through, you know. You will make the interview. So let's leave the different areas to each person that is in charge. And my work here is to point to that, hey, there is smoke over there, you know. We need to rush over and look what is going on. Hopefully there is nothing. But if there is, it's better to react very quickly to avoid the classical, and I cite one of the European Union publications, Late Lessons from Early Warnings. And I have even used it and asked sometimes that, maybe we're heading for too late lessons of early warnings, especially when you look outside of human beings and on other species. My favorite sort of, or should we say the dark favorite, the monster under my bed, that spells bacteria. And I'm thinking about several studies, but particularly one which I read 2017, Tahiri and co-workers, they investigated normal, ordinary bacteria that you and I have on us and in us right now. They exposed it either to 2D, the old GSM phone radiation, or to modern Wi-Fi router radiation. And to make a long story short, not very much happened with the bacteria apart from one thing. They became antibiotic resistant. The very same year this paper was published, 2017, the G20 countries had a special meeting here in Europe only about the fact that at that time, more than 25,000 Europeans died prematurely because of antibiotic resistance in healthcare. And they said that by 2050, worldwide, not only Europe, but the whole planet, it would be in the order of 10 million people losing their lives because of antibiotic resistance in healthcare. And the G20 countries and the yes. scientists, the hearing co-workers, they didn't know about each other. But if you merge them together, then the 10 million people in 2050 could be 7.6 billion people instead. Because what the medical doctors say is that if someone doesn't come up quickly with a new antibiotic, then people will start dying soon from like a splinter in their thumb, which we did at the end of the 1900th century. And I heard just a few days ago, and I didn't know that, that the World Health Organization in Switzerland, Geneva, they have pointed to that antibiotic resistance may become the largest crisis ever, making the corona crisis look like lukewarm soup, really, you know. So they are aware of this. And I even called the a relative to me who is an orthopedic surgeon, and she said it's a dramatic issue. And we talk about it more or less every day, but we are not allowed to go public with this discussion, not to make people afraid and scared. So the fear mongering, no, I don't see that. I've never heard any of my colleagues say that now we should really try to make people afraid. I've never heard that, you know.
Yeah.
So I think the fear mongering here is actually the crude reality, showing us that antibiotic resistance is an ever increasing, rapidly increasing problem. The reduction of pollinators is dramatic in the world, and so on. And this kind of issues may overtake the kind of questions we are dealing with right now. And again, I hope I'm wrong.
Yeah, this is. I want to put. I had several thoughts when you talked about that. The first is this entire discussion of EMFs and the precautionary principle. I think, in my opinion, after years studying this and dedicating all my time to it, is there's a context in which this discussion happens, and this context is an epidemic. A real worldwide epidemic of chronic disease in the adult population, where we know that it's not genes. Most in autism, in Alzheimer's, in diabetes, and so many aspects, they know that it's a maximum of a third normally of these cases are due to genes, and sometimes it's 5%. And then in many papers in these, let's say, subcategories of a smaller niche of scientific research or medical research, they say, well, it's probably at least 50% environmental causes. But then they don't define environmental causes. It's a question mark. And then we don't have a follow-up to that. Environmental causes, right? So we're exposed to chemicals. We're exposed to new agents. We have modern stressors of all kind. solitude, social media, the psyche, the human psyche changes, and society is organized in different ways. We also have many agents which have been introduced without proper safety testing and could act in synergy. And that's the work of Dr. Kostov that I've read tremendously, and very, very concerning, of course, because it just shows you that we're just left to guess or to hope that these synergies are not happening between environmental chemicals and these EMFs also. What you're essentially saying, if I understand you correctly, is that there's smoke alarms all over the place, whether it's antibiotic resistance, it's the loss of fertility in men that is at the moment an extreme concern in Europe and the Western world. So that I'm not making things up. Autism epidemic, it is a disaster around the world that is only increasing. Alzheimer's, dementia. So I don't want to be a bummer, but these are the stats. When you look at chronic disease, it's not getting better. So if we have a discussion in 2020, if we had a discussion in 2020, but everything is fine, everyone's healthy, well, it would be a different discussion. There wouldn't be the urgency to figure out, well, is it contributing or even causing some of this chronic disease? Because in the end, what do we wish for society as humanists? I think you're one of them too, like me. Well, we wish for everyone to live a long, healthy, and happy life, and that's it. And for society to be calm and organized, and everyone's happy with each other. But if we have chronic disease, it causes a lot of drama, unnecessary illness, and death, and that's a shame. And that's why I do what I do, and I know that's why you keep going, is, well, we have these indications, so we need to look at them. But then we've talked about the entire circle, so they're not looking at it because who's responsible to look at this link with Wi-Fi and antibiotic resistance? Well, no one. And then who gets the funding to research a topic that could make an industry either crumble with lawsuits or have to invest billions in R&D to change their way? So the status quo is preferable to a big industry. How do we get out of that? That's a big question, but how do we study things? Is it really another study that we need, or is it something else that we need at this point?
Oh, that's an excellent comment, and question, because once a week I feel that, yes, we need a lot more studies. Yeah. And then another day I think, no, wait,
exactly.
I mean, we have so many peer review-based publications pointing all of them in the same direction. We don't need more. We need some kind of practical action or solution, as we talked about before. And then I do as you do, I go to, for instance, different environmental organizations and ask them, what are you doing? I mean, you have the environment as your table to work from. And then they start talking, but they never touch on, for instance, electromagnetic fields. They don't want to talk about it. And furthermore, when I meet scientists or politicians or civil servants that say, as you said before, that this growing tendency of disease is due to unknown environmental factors, I ask them, well, unknown, shouldn't we investigate them? I mean, it's not rocket science, really. I mean, it's rather simple investigations that needs to be done, even based on registers, which Sweden has a lot of and very detailed, and look for trends. We have actually tried for the last couple of months since the corona, we cannot do very much, but we can access different registers to look for trend changes and base discussions upon it. But it always boils down to that we want to make very simple experiments. One dream experiment, and you talked about this digital detox before, and it has really become a business model. I see more and more people, and yeah, often very, very expensive, very posh. Maybe you digitally detox, but you definitely do not detox when it comes to food and wine and pleasure. It's very expensive, so it's not for scientists really. And but along these lines, I've always dreamt about the study we wanted to do many years ago, namely to take a small town in Sweden, the name is Ljungby, I think it's in the order of 13,000 people living there. And for 1 or 2 years, we would just remove everything. They would be able to call like an ambulance and the fire brigade, but not listening to radio, not watching television, not using cell phones, tablet, baby alarms, nothing like that. And the only thing we wanted to see is, would the healthy population, and healthy within quotation marks really, would they become better and better if we remove the exposure? But then we were met with the comment that no, we cannot allow you to do this. That wouldn't be, and I quote, that would be unethical. We wanted to increase the health parameters, but that was unethical. So we were not allowed to do it. We are still hoping to do some kind of experiment, and it would be very useful to have such a big, I mean, 13,000 is not big in a sense, but at the same time, you get a very good basis to draw conclusions. And just to see, to interview them like every second month, and put this simple question, how do you feel? And see, will the answers go upwards? Will they lay stable, or will they go downwards? And from other studies using, as you say, digital detox situations, uncontrolled, so they're not really scientific, but the trend is very, very clear. People do feel very well not having to deal with all these gadgets. And one thing that they start doing again is to actually talk to each other. And I don't mean between families, but inside of the family. The mother and father and the kids start to communicate instead of only doing this, you know, looking at the smartphone. And that has been, and please God forgive me for saying this, but there is actually a good side to the corona crisis. Here in Sweden, people definitely have started to talk to each other much more. Oh. They are very keen on meeting, sitting down, talking. And I always test people just throwing out, you know, some knowledge or fact or information, and people are really very keen on it, you know. And also the physical contact, and it may sound strange in a sense, you know, I mean, we're talking about a democracy like Sweden, but people, they have kind of forgotten how to give each other a hug. They know how to contact Facebook, but they have forgotten how to make a physical contact. And also I see that, and this is official statistics, the number of kittens and puppies that have been bought has gone like a rocket, you know. People are needing something for their immediate contact. And you have to remember, we don't have any lockdown. I haven't changed anything, and I mean anything in my life, apart from one thing. If I see someone keeping distance, I don't run after them, breathing on them. That's the only. Otherwise, I do exactly all the things I did 2019, 2018, 2017, and so on, you know. And I attend all the meetings, and I travel around with train, tram, underground bus, blah, 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 go to restaurants, coffee shops, bowling alleys, whatever, anything. But still, people, they crave some other form of communication. So maybe if you call me like in 100 years, we will have a new society, but maybe it will look in a sense old. Old meaning like in the 80s or 70s or 60s or 50s, you know.
I think so. I think, I'm not in this situation. I'm in Montreal. I'm in Canada. So we're lockdown after lockdown. So I won't dive into coronavirus that much, because it would be another discussion and a very long drawn out discussion. Yeah. I appreciate that you see a good side to this. And I know that here in Canada, what I can comment on is once this is over, people will appreciate much more being with each other and hugging each other. I think when you remove something, you realize how much you needed it, and human contact for a lot of people, including myself, Zoom communications like this one, it's not sufficient to fill me up with human contact. For certain people, it is. It might be, but for me, I miss going to a coffee shop, and I can't wait until they reopen. Not initially even to talk to people at the coffee shop. Sometimes I'm just working alone, listening to my music. But being in proximity with human beings is just something I think we are very social creatures. So I appreciate you've realized that, and maybe another part to this coronavirus thing is I realize that a lot of people we've been talking about who dies of coronavirus. Well, it's our elderly, and our elderly are very sick. And why are they sick? Well, a lot of people have realized, you know what? We should try to age with grace and health. So we should take care of preventative measures and changing the way you use your cell phone and maybe reducing your exposure to all this radiation might be part of those steps. So I see a big interest in overall preventative measures for good health. So maybe there's going to be, among everything that has happened that is either tragic or causes a lot of polarization and anger, there are good parts to this also, to any crisis. And I think as far as EMFs goes, I saw the awareness really grow this year.
Yeah, and I mean, you sound actually like a representative for a company which I cannot reveal, but based in Malaysia, and they are exactly along your lines of thinking, and maybe in the future, and in the very near future, and you mentioned Mudita from Poland, if you kind of merge that with the cases from RP of Sweden and so on, so on. I mean, tomorrow you might have completely other devices for communication, but together with that, a complete new behavior. However, I said some days I want this, some days I want that. And the third day, sometimes, I get a haunting feeling that when this corona is over, no, maybe we will just go back and be as before, and we will continue with this magic smartphone and Instagram and Twitter and Facebook and Google and whatever. And I hope not, of course. Well, let's see. I have at least got a lot of new friends thanks to Corona. So, well, as I said, there are ups and downs to everything.
Yeah, and that's a good way to close is to say, well, we have the internet, and we're if you listen to this entire conversation, we're definitely not against technology. I'm very grateful. I'm able to connect with one of the most important colleagues in my field, Olle Johansson from Sweden, which is completely incredible to me. A few decades ago, I wouldn't be able to have this personal access and then share it with thousands of people around the globe. It's really amazing. So I wish for that to continue in a safer way. And that's the message today. Professor
And
Johansson, go
I
ahead.
would even take it one step further, not only in a safer way, but in a safe way.
Yes, there you go. Finally, in a safe way. That's true. Because safer, and a lot of people will try to do safer first, and we have to decipher what is marketing and what is truth and still use your cell phone in a safe way. And the only way to safely use a cell phone is probably not to use one at the moment. But
At the moment,
let's do
indeed.
safer, and let's hope that companies come up with something safe eventually. We're working on that. So how can people support your research? You mentioned the fundraiser, it's still going. I'm gonna have links in the episode. Is there anything you're working on you want to mention to
Oh,
listeners?
we have just several publications ready. The coming days, I will send them out using my mailing lists. One is about honeybees, actually. Another one is about heart rate variability. There are studies around the corner. And also, I mean, I have been very much occupied with measurements here in Stockholm and surrounding Stockholm, especially regarding the coming 5G, as we started with that, also trying to get some critical studies up and running. Including also plants and other forms of animals. We are not lazy. We are trying to do our very best.
This is tremendous. So please donate generously to Professor Johansson and his colleagues. Really, you're helping science, independent science, I have to mention, in a topic where corporate interests can be a big problem. And I've talked that I've done an entire episode of podcast on the corporate interest. I've got another episode of podcast I wanted to mention about insurers leaving the boat, where I talk about a lot of what you've reported and the different reports that have been created by insurance companies saying, nope, we will not insure people for EMF damage. So that's very interesting. Professor Johansson, I hope I'm going to have another conversation with you in the future. Well, and I'm very grateful for all you do. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.